Dear colleagues, I would like to present you an idea about ability of human mind to develop more than one representation of time flow. Actually, we are used in social science and in humanities and also in economics, I mean, this modeling of intertemporal decision making. Yeah. Okay. To apply a cognitive representation of time flow where we have a timeline and usually line and usually a single temporal process. But I believe there are arguments to speak about multiple cognitive representations of time flow. But before I present my studies, I just say a few phrases about explanations. Actually, every kind of explanation is formulated upon explanandum and explanans. And actually, every sentence has objects which are presented by our cognitive systems. Moreover, John Freid has shown in a number of studies that a cognitive representation has own temporal dimension, even when it is a representation of a non-moving object. It looks like every kind of cognitive representation potentially includes this temporal dimension. And I propose to make a step forward. I argue that human mind is able to develop more than one cognitive representation of time flow, even for one and the same object. Thus, having a number of cognitive representations of time flow, one should expect the numerous ways for variation of an object over time. And that's why a multitude of cognitive representations of time should be considered in the series of explanations. I'm not speaking here about one concrete approach, but just in general about explanations. So let us agree in the very beginning that human mind is able to produce at least one cognitive representation of time flow. There are different arguments for existence of such a representation, but I will skip it over. I believe it is almost generally accepted that we have cognitive representation of time flow. And now I'd like just metaphorically introduce my approach. You know the story that for studying the properties of gravitational field, Galileo has thrown different objects into gravitational field and examined the behavior of the objects. I propose you to do something similar, even more simple. Here is our cognitive representation of time flow, and let us throw not different, but even two equal objects into this cognitive representation of time flow. And let us see how the attractiveness or the other properties of these objects change over time. That was just a general description of the approach. And hypothesis is, if there is a singular cognitive representation of time flow, it must show the same properties when it is applied for processing of one and the same object. Therefore, one and the same object being thrown in time flow must show the same variation over time at the same time interval. That is a general idea and quite metaphorically expressed, but let us do it as experiment. Imagine that here is our cognitive representation of time flow. Since we are here now in Krakow, let us throw two objects like two banknotes of 10 zloty. So I believe everyone agrees that if I show you these two banknotes at time moment T1, I mean at the present time moment, they are equally attractive for you. My question is whether they are equally attractive at some later point T2. When they are equally attractive and have the same value, possibly we have to do with the same properties of time flow. I skip here a theoretical part, but I will mention that the idea that we have a situation on propositional time flow came to me when I have studied electoral behavior in our presidential elections in 2010. The idea is that you can even impact not only the decision about money, but also about electoral behavior. And here, in this experiment 1A, I am speaking about a cognitive representation for situation on propositional time flow. Just as example, I show you task 1 for activation of situational time flow. I will read the task so that you get the feeling how you can activate the situational time flow, and you will see just. Please imagine that in 4 days you will go to the supermarket to buy a notebook for 3,199 Ukrainian hryvnias, or in Polish zloty, it doesn't matter now. When you choose a notebook, you will be going to the cash desk. A shop assistant informs you that the notebook you wish to buy is on sale for 3,100 Ukrainian hryvnias at the other branch of the store. Would you make the trip to the other store? Actually, the question is whether are you ready to save 99 Ukrainian hryvnias. It is about 35 zloty or possibly 9 euro, at least at the time when the experiment was done. And in the second task, I have the following coordinate. Please imagine that you went to the supermarket of electronics and are to buy a notebook for 3,199 Ukrainian hryvnias. When you choose a notebook and are going to the cash desk, a shop assistant informs you that the notebook you wish to buy will in 4 days be on sale for 3,100 Ukrainian hryvnias at the other branch of the store. Would you make the trip to the other store? Actually, you again have to decide whether you accept this proposal to save the same 99 hryvnias. And if you look at task one and task two, it is mathematically one and the same task. You are staying here at the present time moment now, and you have to wait, in our case, 4 days or X days, doesn't matter, to save 99 hryvnias. And in both cases, probability that you save this money is about 100%, because you will be in the very first day of the sell out. So from mathematical point, we shouldn't get any different results. But here are the results. What do you see here? Here is the percentage of positive answers, percent of yes. Here is propositional time flow. Here is situational time flow. And as you see, when we activate a propositional time flow, the 39% of people are ready to accept this monetary saving. But when you activate situational time flow, 57% of people agree to take this saving opportunity. So it looks like despite the equality of amounts of money, I mean absolute equality and relative saving equality, we got different decision outcomes. I have done also other experiment with more difficult design. I will skip it now because we don't have time for it. I have tried to combine together even the propositional time flow and situational time flow. Anyway, it looks like our mind distinguishes them and counts differently one time flow from the other time flow. So as a first conclusion, I would propose the following one. Actually, we have possibly one overgeneralized representation of time flow, but under this representation, we have two separate representations, one for situational time flow and the other one for propositional time flow. But I went one step further. I have studied the cognitive representations of propositional, only propositional time flow model from the first and the third person perspective. Actually, you know, all of us are very social creatures and we need each other. We exchange with each other different values, items, money, actually ideas, knowledge. We cannot survive without each other. That's why I thought possibly we could have different cognitive representation of time flow for myself or for somebody other. The procedure seems to be quite similar. So we have again this hypothetical time flow, and we throw again 10 zloty. In my experiment, of course, Ukrainian hryvnias, but here you can put 10 zloty. And the question is whether at the time point T2, this 10 zloty remains the same when you look at this amount of money from the first person perspective and from the third person perspective. Actually, what is interesting for me is that the third person perspective is developed in the same mind. So the question is whether this first person perspective and third person perspective on the same amount of money, of money at the time T2 is the same. So the question is how the change of the personal perspective influences a decision about monetary saving proposition and how it impacts on the corresponding framing effect. In these experiments, I have used a little bit different kind of framing effect, actually, in the sense of Tversky and Kahneman. I believe most of you know this almost classical jacket and calculator problem. I have taken this problem from Tversky and Kahneman and slightly modified it. So in the first task, you will recognize this. This wording from the first person perspective, present time order. In the experiment 2A, I'm speaking about aging of saving proposition. Aging means we will throw money into the past time order. And we will see how they change when they came up to present time. So here is a task for the first person perspective, present time order. So just you get feeling what it is about to be subject in such studies. Imagine that you came to a store of electronics and you are about to buy a headphone for 790 hryvnias and a microphone for 120. You choose the headphone, but a shop assistant informs you that the same headphone is on sale for 750 hryvnias at the other branch of the store. Would you make the trip to the other store? But what actually you have to notice in this task? You have chance to save 40 hryvnias, the difference between 790 and 750. But in this case, 40 hryvnias are equal approximately to 5% of relative saving. And there is a second task. Imagine that you came to a store of electronics that are about to buy headphone for 120 hryvnias and microphone for 790 hryvnias. You choose the headphone, but a shop assistant informs you that the same headphone is on sale for 80 hryvnias at the other branch of the store. Would you make the trip to the other store? So now you have a chance to save 40 hryvnias, but the relative price reduction is about 33%. I'm skipping the theoretical background. You can find it by Tversky and Kahneman, but ideas or the basic outcome, what is important for my study is that usually the task two gives a higher number of positive responses than the task one. So if you propose the same absolute amount of money to save, but relative amount is quite high, I don't see that, okay, quite high like here, you will get almost in all cases the higher percentage of yes responses. Moreover, I have added the third person perspective. I have proposed a little bit different wording of task. And here you see the third person perspective in the present time order. So imagine that student of the same year came to a store of electronics and is about to buy a headphone for 790 hryvnias and microphone for 120. A student chooses a headphone, but a shop assistant informs student that the same headphone is on sale for 750 hryvnias at the other branch of the store. So would a student make the trip to the other store? Now you as subject have to decide whether the other student will accept this saving opportunity, whether the other student will be ready to save 40 hryvnias under such conditions. Task two is actually almost the same, only the relative amount is changed. 120 and 80 hryvnias are in play. And as I told you, in this case, we throw the money into past time order. So here is the task for past time order condition, third person perspective. Imagine that the student of the same year came to a store of electronics and is about to buy a headphone for 790 hryvnias and a microphone for 120 hryvnias. The student chooses the headphone, but a shop assistant informs students that the same headphone went on sale 3 days before for 750 hryvnias at the other branch of the store. Would a student make the trip to the other store? What do you see here? Actually, all other parameters keep the same, but you see here this 3 day of aging. I call it aging, I mean, it's not real aging, but the proposition is 3 days old. And who knows, possibly you don't have now a chance to use this proposition. Task two was formulated in a similar way, and here is a general design of the whole experiment. But what is important for us now? Here is the first person perspective, third person perspective, 5% saving, 33% saving, again 5, 33. And you see here different times, present time, mode, and past. Present and past. And for us it's interesting actually how the framing effect, which we have to expect according to Tversky and Kahneman, under between these two conditions, changes under these conditions. And the change is actually the result of application of cognitive representation of time flow. And here are the results. Because of the time budget, I will show only for 40 grievances, but they are actually almost similar. So what do you see here? Here is first-person perspective. Third-person perspective, here is percentage of positive responses. Present time order, past time order, present pass, and solid line is 33% saving, I mean relative saving, and dashed line is 5% saving. So for the present time order, you, I got the almost classical framing effect according to Tversky and Kahneman. And what do you see further? When a proposition is of age, I mean the proposition is under process of aging, the framing effect eliminates. And in this case, we have small framing effect, which is not significant. Under other conditions, I got a total elimination up to zero, and there was even condition when you can get an inversion of framing effect when a small relative saving is more preferred than the high relative saving. But it is not interesting in consideration of the my question. Here is a third person perspective. No framing effect for the present time order, but one very, very significant framing effect for the past time order. And what we shall combine here, actually, the difference in manifestation of the framing effect. And this difference is due to the different way how time flow, I mean cognitive representation time flow, if impacts on the different relative savings. For the first person perspective, high relative saving ages very quickly, and low relative saving ages quite slowly. That's why they came here together. And oppositely, for the third person perspective, high relative saving ages slowly, and low relative saving ages very quickly. So it means like aging process, at least a cognitive representation of aging process for monetary saving proposition seems to be different from the first and the third person perspective. I have done also study within the future time mode. It is experiment about first and third person perspective on saving proposition made in future. And also I have studied their impact on manifestation of the framing effect in the sense of Tversky and Kahneman. Actually, here is the whole design of the experiment. First person perspective, as you see, third person perspective, 5% saving, 33% saving, again, 5% saving, 33% saving. And again, present time order and future time order. Now we throw money into the future. Again, present future. And here are the results. I show only for one absolute amount of saving, but for the other cases, they are similar. So what you see here? Here is first person perspective, third person perspective. Here is percentage of positive responses. Here is percentage of positive responses. And again, present, future, present, future. For the present time order, we got, again, a framing effect, like in case with Tversky and Kahneman. And when you throw money in future, in this and in the other study, we got almost equal decline of general readiness to follow saving proposition. And more or less framing effect remains also in the future time order. But from the third person perspective, it looks like this waiting impacts a little bit different, especially low relative saving. That's why in the very beginning, I mean, at the present time order, you don't have a framing effect, and framing effect rises quite strongly for the future time condition. So it looks like cognitive representation of waiting also differently impacts on, especially on the low relative savings in future time order. And despite that this first and the third person perspective are produced by the same mind, at least for the time flow representations, I would say that we produce different representations of time flow. That's why as a T2, amount of money proposed for saving is not always equally accepted. So at this stage, I would say that we probably have a separate cognitive representation or cognitive representations of time flow with different properties for situational time flow, propositional time flow, and within propositional time flow, we can distinguish propositional time flow from the first person perspective and third person perspective. I don't believe I have time, but I ask you just to believe that in the other experiments, I have shown that we can distinguish within the propositional time flow from the first person perspective, aging in past and past openness. These two cognitive processes run within the past time mode and they have different impact on the decision about monetary saving proposition. Of course, there is a presence as also as temporal process, which means just availability. You can get it just now. And within future time order, I distinguish also two temporal processes. One is, I call it zero probability barrier. It is just simple waiting. You wait for opportunity, but opportunity doesn't change probability to be realized. And there is aging in future. It sounds possibly strange, but you can you can prepare a wording of tasks so that future opportunity will be under aging process, despite that it hasn't started yet. Yeah, I mean, that is all what I can report for now. I'm running now studies, possibly here we can get some other branches, but I don't believe that it's all possible ways how a human mind can represent different versions of time flow. And the conclusion is that a singular cognitive representation of time flow cannot show different properties when it is applied to one and the same object, like a unit of money. Therefore, we can speak or we should speak about a multitude of cognitive representations of time flow. And I will comment here only this lower picture. So, a multiplicity of cognitive time flow representations means that the multiple ways for evaluation of one object, I mean one item, one proposition, or human being, or some action from moral perspective over time. And it means that a multitude, it means that because of this multitude of evaluation, we should expect also multitude of explanations. That was actually one of the ideas I wish to mention. So thank you for your attention. I believe we have 5 minutes for questions. Yeah, of course.
So they have basically the same income, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So my naive speculation here is that when you're thinking about somebody else, you're thinking more in terms of morality, what you should do. I mean, you should save money if you can, and a 20-minute trip is not so troublesome for somebody else. But when you think about it for yourself, you know you should save money, but going 20 minutes doesn't pay, say, 40 units is not worth the trouble. So there is a difference in perspective here that boils down to how moral you think the issue is. Would that be a possible solution or explanation?
That's a good question. Actually, in your first remark, you catch the point. Actually, I take the subjects from the technical university. At this university, we have quite homogeneous students in relation to income. And, you know, my impression is, I mean, after conversation with real students, income of students in Ukraine is not very high. And, I mean, they don't consider the moral aspects in this case. And they just count how much does it cost for them in comparison to their monthly income. I don't believe I have broken something from the moral perspective. Did I get right your question? I don't know.
Yeah, no, it's a question of how you view the difficulty of getting to the analogy. dynamics do it. It doesn't seem to approach.
But anyway, you see that I didn't get 100% of people who are ready to follow the saving money proposition, yeah? It means that I didn't propose, for example, if I go higher than 60 hryvnias, yeah, absolute amounts, it is very probable that this framing effect just collapsed, it eliminates. I mean, we reach this upper threshold when it doesn't matter how high is relative saving or how low it is. They just follow this absolute amount of saving. That's all. But I believe with this amount of money, I was just according to their expectations and their income.
When you support, it's easy to conceive somebody else's action as coherent than your own. But when you're thinking about somebody else, it's easy to think that they will do what they should, or what you think of them doing yourself. But that's not my question. My question is, how does the different sensations of time, because you know how you have a different period, you feel time flowing variously, and there's this emotional effect. How does this figure into the representations?
Did you talk about inversion or?
No. I'm talking that in life you have various sensations of time flow, different speeds. And those are effective representations, if you like, of time. How does that figure into your ideas of different representations of time flow?
I don't believe I considered it. Actually, my subjects also was not informed that the study is about cognitive representation of time flow. It is between subjects' design, and every time they were instructed that this study on decision making, and they have to decide whether they accept saving money or not. So I don't believe I have considered your factors you mentioned in my study.
The third person case strikes me as an interesting one to try to get a contrast between predictions between the simulation theory and the theory for understanding others' behavior or predicting others' behavior. I wonder whether theoretically proponents of the simulation theory would predict that if the decision has to be fast, then one would tend to think the student would do what one would do, and if the theory is the one used, which might be more likely if more time elapses, then what one takes to be the correct solution would prevail. Of course, I don't really know that these two would have different predictions, but the situation strikes me as interesting for that contrast between those two kinds of theories.
Oh. I'm not sure whether I really understand your question, but...
Do you recognize the contrast I'm drawing between these two theories for understanding others' behavior?
Yeah, but I don't know. Actually, I looked at my study more in psychological way. Just I try to make a task as much as possible near to the real life. I mean, the prices are... Despite the differences you see in the prices, yeah, I chosen the items which have real prices in supermarkets, and students actually take decisions within 1 minute, not more. So theory of theory, that's good, but I mean, real decision making in life takes not usually more than a few seconds actually, and especially if people decide whether they follow this proposition or not. I didn't get your question. No?
Well, no. I think you're bringing out that it isn't really clear what the two theories would predict if we allow more time. We might need a more complex decision to get a real difference in prediction between what happens with a couple of seconds where you can simulate and what happens in a longer period where you can reflect and do subjective reasoning.
Yeah, I see. You know, my intuition is that if you give the students more time, they just forget this task and they will switch to the other one. I mean, they are not ready. I'm also not ready to spend more than 2 minutes to think about this 20 hryvnias or sitwa hryvnias, I mean, it is not a big amount of money.
Thank you.